What's up, everybody? It's Punk Rock Talk, episode 36. Today, my guests are the Casket Creatures. You're listening to 112 Ocean Avenue. It's on our Spotify playlist, Rebellion Noise 2022. If you are not following our playlist yet, you need to do that. You can find it on Spotify by searching for Rebellion Noise 2022 or by going straight to the Havoc's Spotify page. Scroll to the bottom and you'll see the playlist there. Have you missed an old episode of Punk Rock Talk? Not to fear. Every episode is on the Havoc's YouTube channel. Have you subscribed to our channel yet? If you haven't, you need to do that too. And while you're there, click or tap on the bell icon. That'll notify you every time we upload new content to the channel. Not just episodes of Punk Rock Talk, anything that we upload there. And we are always working on something new. All right. This episode of Punk Rock Talk and every episode of Punk Rock Talk is brought to you by our wonderful sponsor, Dead and Buried Inc. Are you in a band? Do you need merchandise? They are your source. They can print literally anything. T-shirts, patches, buttons, stickers, banners, you name it, they can do it. This episode of Punk Rock Talk is also brought to you by Rebellion Noise Records. Now, I have been saying for the last few weeks that there are going to be some announcements made for Rebellion Noise Records. The first announcement comes today, right now, right here on Punk Rock Talk. I am so pleased to announce that we now have a website for Rebellion Noise Records. You can find the link to that on our Instagram page in the bio section. And not only is the website live, but you can also finally order compilations, physical media, CD compilations. There's two available right now. The 40 Fest 2023 sampler, as well as Punk Rock Attack Volume 1. I've had several people reach out and say, hey man, I am interested in getting one of those compilations. How can I get it? None of the bands that are on it are near me. I can't get it from the merch table, yada, yada, yada. Well, now you have a way to order it. And here's the best part. It's free. It's free. All you need to do is cover shipping. There's a flat rate charge of $5 to cover shipping. I don't think that's too much to ask. However, with each release on our site, in the images gallery, there is a Venmo link. And if you would like to make a donation to Rebellion Noise Records, just scan that Venmo link and send it over. It's also on the homepage. You know, this whole thing has been bootstrapped and funded by the artists from the get-go. So having donations made will help us pour money back into it so that we can continue to release new compilations with other bands and spread the music. Okay. Let's see here. I'm going to go ahead and do this. If you've been tuning in every week, you're familiar with this. Our good friend Brittany from Oil Change is going to be undergoing heart surgery sometime next year. There is a GoFundMe page on Oil Change's Instagram. The link is in their bio section. If you would like to make a contribution, have a heart, will ya? I'm sure they would greatly appreciate it. And also kind of a fun announcement they made just today. They're actually going to be playing in Hollywood in December, December 17th, with the Peppermint Creeps. If you're not familiar with who the Peppermint Creeps are, that band was kind of like, you know, I mean, everybody in Hollywood knew who they were. And Brittany's dad was actually the drummer for the Peppermint Creeps. Sadly, he passed away. And the band has been inactive since then. So this is their first show in 10 years. And how exciting that Oil Change gets to open the show. It's super cool. So if you're in Southern California, that would be a really cool show for you to go to. And just hang out. Meet the guys in Oil Change. Meet Brittany. And check out the Peppermint Creeps. It's going to be a fun show. Okay. Having said that, I think it's time to move on and invite our guest. Let me go ahead and get that invitation sent. And while we're waiting for the casket creatures, if you have questions for myself or the casket creatures during this interview, you can submit them by tapping that question mark icon on your device. Please do not put them in the comments section. I don't really pay attention to that. It gets lost there. So again, just tap that question mark icon on your device and you can submit your questions there. And you can, guys. All right, invitation has been sent. So hopefully we get, there we go. What's up, buddy? Can you hear me?
Absolutely.
Awesome. Before we get started, one, I'd like to thank you for taking the time to be my guest today here on Punk Rock Talk. But also, could you please just introduce yourself, the name of the band, what you do in the band, and where the band is from?
Yeah, absolutely. So I'm Ryan Cadaver. I'm the singer of the Casket Creatures. We're based out of Atlanta, Georgia. Some would say Gainesville, Georgia. That's kind of where we got our start. You know, we were kicking around in a small town called Gainesville, but we mainly play out in Atlanta. So, but yeah, we're a horror punk band, and we've been around since 2012, I think. And yeah, we've got a lot of albums and a lot of music that we've put out.
Awesome, man. Well, I'm excited to have you on here. 'Tis the season for horror punk.
Absolutely. This is our time.
Absolutely. Yeah, man. October is my favorite month of the year. It's my birthday month. My due date was actually Halloween, but I came a couple days early. So this is like, you know, I live for this month. Every other month out of the year, I'm just kind of like waiting for October to roll back around. But one of the things that I love about it so much is the music. And you guys have very nicely taken the horror theme and wrapped it into your own version. And like you said, you've been doing it for a long time. And the most recent release, I think, was 2019, correct?
Yeah. So Folklore was our last full release. We're working on a new one soon. We're also talking about redoing some of our old records as well, just to give them like a little facelift. But yeah, man, that was the last thing we put out. And Folklore, like the song you were playing earlier, is a lot different than everything else we've put out. It's a little on the heavier direction, a little spookier, and but like not in a spooky Halloween way like a lot of our stuff. It was more in a creepy, like, satanic evil sort of way, but still equally fun to me.
Awesome. Yeah, I noticed that the production value increased a bit with that one too. And one thing I've got to compliment you on is the vocals.
Hey, I appreciate that.
Yeah, no problem, man. Horror punk is kind of one of those things where, like, I feel like it's so easy to fall into the trap of, like, well, we've got to sound like Danzig.
Yeah.
And you just immediately remove any originality from your sound by doing that. So I have to applaud you for not doing that, because your vocal style to me sounds like it's just very much you. It's not trying to rip off somebody else. And that's not easy to do as a vocalist, because, like I said, you know, it's kind of easy to fall into this trap of, like, well, who's my main influence? And I'm going to kind of go for that instead of just being authentic. But you do a great job of having that authenticity to your vocal style.
I appreciate that, man. I got a lot of influences. I'm a big punk guy, obviously, but I'm also really into thrash metal. I'm also really into Iron Maiden. So a lot of that stuff kind of adds to a lot of how I approach doing these songs. You know, especially like Iron Maiden, a lot of like our songs, I'm telling a story, you know, it's not just, you know, the paint by numbers kind of thing, you know, which I mean, I like a lot of that stuff too. And we do a lot of the woes and a lot of the cliche stuff because it's fun. It's a good time, but I like to approach things from like a storytelling perspective. And like, I think of almost every song that the Cast Creatures do as like a music video, like I already have the music video planned out before the song's even out. So I have a very visual style with how I go with things. And as far as my singing, I mean, I've been singing since I was a kid. I was in a lot of metal bands growing up, then started doing some punk bands. And, you know, I was doing a band called Brain Buffet, which was like the precursor to the Casket Creatures. But, you know, even then, you know, we were kind of doing some different kind of sounding stuff. And it's not intentional. Like you said, that's just how I sound. That's just my voice. I'm not intentionally trying to sound a certain way. I can't. When we cover Misfit songs, I don't sound anything like Danzig, and I can't. So I applaud the people that can nail it, but I like to do my own thing. You know, I work with what I've been given.
For sure, man. Like you were saying, you know, some of the cliche things with the genre, like the woes and stuff. Like, I totally get that, because at the end of the day, you know, you have to realize that you are in somewhat of a box, you know, like it's punk rock, and like, it's totally good to be within the box.
Yeah. But then, for sure,
you know, throwing in your own vibe to it. That's what's important.
Yeah. And we've been around long enough to where we don't want to just put out the same album over and over again. So, you know, we try to approach things where we're like, all right, you know, let's try to go a little out of the box with this one. Let's try to do something different. But even then, like, even our last album still had a punk rock banger, like Bloody Mary. Like, there's still, like, the punk rock tracks, the classic horror punk songs on every album.
You mentioned also about, you know, having music videos thought out before songs are released, and, like, how the visual element is really important to you. And I think that, you know, just goes hand in hand with horror, because it's such a visual genre.
Yeah.
What kind of, you know, was the beginning of all of that for you? For me, it was like being a little kid and seeing Nightmare on Elm Street part 3.
Oh yes, the Dream Warriors.
Yeah,
that's my, like, favorite one.
I saw that at a very, very young age. I think I was like 5. And you know, for any kid at that age to see Freddy Krueger for the first time, absolutely frightening.
Oh yeah.
But with that sensation of being frightened, something else happened. I became so intrigued and ultimately fell in love with the horror genre. And especially the 80s and early 90s.
Yeah. Yeah. That's definitely my bag too. The 80s horror is my favorite. But I think the first introduction I had was actually Night of the Living Dead.
Okay.
Yeah. The original, like the black and white one, watched that and it scared the crap out of me. And also, I have very vivid memories being very, very young, and my dad watching The Exorcist, and man, that was something. And I remember just peeking behind the couch, watching parts of it, and being terrified and running back off. But it was the same thing like you're saying, like you're intrigued. You're like, there's something about this that I like. And from a very early age, I was like, you know, I would buy, you know, toys like everybody else, but like I would always want like the spooky characters and like the horror characters. Like I had Ninja Turtles, but like I wanted the Ninja Turtles that look like vampires and you know, Frankenstein and stuff like that. Like I, you know, I've always gravitated towards spooky stuff, even from a young age. And the same with movies. I mean, I horror movies are the best. And especially this time of year. I mean, I don't know about you, but like I have my regulars that I just have to watch every single year. And I look forward to it. You know, Halloween 3 being one of them that, you know, didn't get a lot of respect for a long time, but now it's in my rotation. Trick or Treat, a few other ones. So, I mean, you know, horror movies are the best, man. They always will be.
Yeah, I kind of am the same way. You know, there's certain movies that I really love to watch during this month. But it's kind of like also any time of the year, you know, like,
For sure.
Anytime I have, you know, a free moment where I can actually watch something horror related, I'm going to make the time to do it. I love that.
Well, I don't know about you, but I also have Christmas horror movies as well that I got lined up. So
like awesome. Black
Christmas, Silent Night, Deadly Night.
Yeah.
I like to theme them to like whatever month we're in, but then the rest of the year, other than the holidays, it's just whatever. Frankenhooker, you know, whatever I got laying around, I'm into it. But I also, I've gotten more into just like the straight up bad horror movies as well. I love the quality stuff, but my wife does a podcast called Caught Dead Watching that's like about the worst horror movies ever. And since I live here, I happen to be on that podcast pretty frequently. So we will sit there and watch some just god awful movie, but we end up having a lot of fun with them. So sometimes the terrible horror movies, if, as long as they have a little bit of heart and like a little bit to like about it, they're a lot of fun too.
It's like Mystery Science Theater 3000.
Exactly. Yeah. Some of the best times I've had over here are just watching something absolutely terrible and just like ragging on it, but also being like, this rules.
That's part of the fun of the genre, though. Like, even for the really good movies.
Yeah.
Like, there's if you think about, especially Nightmare on Elm Street, you know, like, as that franchise progressed, Freddy Krueger kind of turned into this caricature.
Oh, yeah. He became a clown. Like, scary clown, but, you know.
Right. But, yeah. Like, the practical effects that they used... which I think it is so undervalued now because everybody wants to rely on CGI and, you know, digital technology. But, at the time when those movies were released, a lot of those practical effects were absolutely terrifying.
Yeah.
But you look at them now and it's like, oh my God, that's so cheesy. But that's just part of what makes it fun and cool.
Oh, yeah, I know. I love it. Yeah, I mean, there's a lot of stuff in the horror franchises that, you know, like, I'm a big Friday the 13th fan, but, like, those are hit and miss, especially going back now, you know, so it's more hit than miss, in my opinion. Even Jason X was a banger. I like that one, but, you know, Jason in Space was pretty cool. I'm all about, like, even a lot of our stuff, we mix the campiness into our, I think campiness is part of the genre. It's impossible to escape.
No,
I think that people that take horror super, super serious to where they're like, you can only like be into like classic, like horror literature. It's like, I just don't understand you. I'm okay with having a little fun with my horror.
So I can relate to that because dude, I shit you not, man. I get so pissed off if I'm scrolling through Facebook or whatever, and there's like a new horror movie out and like, in the comments section of whatever post is promoting the movie, people are just trashing it and like, oh, it was so bad. I couldn't even sit through it. It's like, okay, first of all, let's just get one thing straight. This is a horror movie.
Yeah.
So you need to be into it for the fun.
Yes.
Second of all, if your bar for the horror genre is way up here, you need to lower it.
Yeah, you're always going to be disappointed.
Exactly. Like, I had to stop having high expectations for movies, horror movies, probably around the year 2000.
Yeah.
Because
the 2000s were rough for horror movies.
You know, like, the only thing, you know, to kind of come out of the early 2000s in the horror genre that I was like, okay, this is unique, this is different, I'm kind of into it, was Saw.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Saw rules.
The thing that I loved about that, though, was, like, the story writing. It always kept you guessing. And, like, the whole gore, you know, element to it. I can roll with it. It's not my favorite.
Yeah.
But there is something about that, especially like when those movies were first coming out. It's like it'd have you on the edge of your seat, like, holy shit, I can't believe, like, you know, this is about to happen for this character or whatever. But like the thing that I had to stop expecting was that there was going to be some new character in any new horror movie that was going to become iconic.
Yeah.
You know, when you think of the horror genre, there's like, you know, the staples of the genre that are still going strong and probably are always going to go strong. And it doesn't leave a lot of room for new characters.
Yeah.
And I think that's kind of shitty, but it just is what it is. So again, man, like people going into these movies, having the bar set so high, it's like, man, you got to realize it is what it is.
Yeah, exactly. And there are some, like, I'm really into these, like, A24 horror films. Like, I'm not going to lie, like Midsommar and Hereditary. I mean, those movies fucked me up. There are some gems coming out for sure. And there's the occasional, like, horror icon that will come out that, you know, still stands the test of time. Captain Spaulding being one of them, you know, obviously the newer incarnation of Pennywise. I prefer the older one, but I mean, the newer one's iconic. It's hard to deny. So yeah, I mean, there's a few. Art the Clown is another one from Terrifier. Right. But you know, yeah, it's kind of hard to beat, you know, Freddy and Jason and Michael. It's just kind of hard to beat them. Leatherface, you know.
You know,
the new Hellraiser was good though. Did you see the new Hellraiser?
I haven't seen it yet.
It's great. I loved it. It was a great Halloween treat.
It's on my list of things to watch, but I haven't gotten around to it yet. I've thought a lot about this over the years, and like, what is it about, you know, the staples that are, you know, why are they iconic? And what I came up with is that it's not necessarily the characters that are frightening; it's the idea behind them that is so terrifying. You know, let's take Michael Myers, for instance. On Halloween night, it's not unusual for anybody to be walking around your neighborhood with a creepy mask on, carrying a knife,
yep,
and hearing screams come out of anyone's house.
Yeah.
You know, it's Halloween night. You just kind of expect it. What's frightening is to think about that someone is actually being murdered in that house by someone that is walking around in presumably just another Halloween costume.
Yeah. Someone who is impossible to kill also.
Yeah. You know, or Freddy Krueger. It's like you're not safe even in your sleep.
That's the worst. Yeah, that's by far the worst.
You know, like you're not having a nightmare. You're living the nightmare and you're going to die.
Yeah. There's no way around it. Yeah, the kids are always trying to stay up. It's not gonna work.
Right. But those ideas are what are so terrifying.
Yeah.
And in contemporary horror, there's not a lot of originality for terrifying ideas. It's kind of like, you know, someone's always trying to reinvent the wheel, but essentially it's still the wheel.
Yeah. Yeah, and it's, I mean, we're, you know, we're just going to have to accept that there's going to be a ton of remakes and reboots and all that. And some of them are good, some of them are not. But, you know, we just got to take the good with the bad and just be glad that horror movies are still getting recognition at all, you know?
Absolutely. Before we continue on, I'd like to take a moment to address the audience. If you have questions for myself or Ryan, tap the question mark icon on your device. You can submit your questions there. We're getting closer to the live Q&A portion of the show. And guys, let's make this fun too. You know, if you would like to ask us about horror movies or anything that is related to the month of October, related to Halloween, go ahead and do that. It doesn't have to be about the music, although I encourage you to submit those questions as well. You know, guys, I tell you every week, this is your moment to have our attention, to ask us whatever you want. So ask away. Having said that, let's talk a little bit more about the band.
Yeah.
I'd love to know what's on the horizon. You and I spoke a little bit about that before the interview started on FaceTime, but we've got to tell the audience what you've got in the works and expand on it a little bit.
Yeah. So you can check us out on our Facebook and Instagram and all that stuff, of course, but we've posted a link to two new songs that we've recorded that you can only get through physical media, at least for now. That'll eventually change, of course. But there are two new songs, The Fog and All Hallows Eve, that are, I'm super, super proud of. They're very fitting for the season. They'll be perfect for your Halloween playlist. And if you're like me, you have a very extensive Halloween playlist, so it would fit right in. And that's out. Like we are putting those, put an order in. They're made to order. So if you want a copy of our two new singles, just hit us up on Facebook or message me or whatever you got to do, and we'll get a copy of it for you. Other than that, I mean, we have several shows coming up. You know, we're going to be in Knoxville, Tennessee this weekend. We're playing with First Jason, who is the guy who was the first person to play Jason. self-explanatory. But, yeah, we're doing a show with him and Ginky Ginky Panic, which is a very cool horror band that you should totally have on. They're a little more like surf horror, but they're super, super cool. They're really interesting dudes. And that's going to be on the 14th at the Brickyard. And then the biggest thing we got going on is the Casket Creatures Halloween Party, which is going to be on the 29th of October. It's going to be in Atlanta, Georgia at Sabbath Brewing. And Sabbath Brewing is kind of turned into like the spot for punk bands and metal bands. It's really, really cool. I'm digging it a lot. And we're going to be playing there doing our Halloween party, which is always just a huge throwdown. My other band's actually opening the show. I'm in a band called Neon Warlords, which is like an 80s action movie come to life. It's ridiculous. So it's a lot of fun too. So, yeah, if you want to check that out, come early. Yeah. But other than that, I mean, you know, we're just like, we have completely thrown ourselves back into this band. We're just trying to like get, yes, every day is Halloween. I just saw somebody's comment. I completely agree. But yeah, we are just going all in on this band, man. We're putting so much work into this on new content, new videos, new album, everything. So, we've really ramped it up. So, we're just excited for people to hear what we got going on. There's a lot of secret stuff that's about to just blow people's minds. So I'm super excited about it.
Awesome. The thing that there's a couple of things that I really love that, you were just talking about, but one of the things that I definitely want to expand on is, releasing physical media. You know, it is such a rarity these days.
Yeah.
I feel like the internet has kind of spoiled us and made us lazy. And physical media is no exception to that. It's so easy to upload music to all of the digital distributors.
Yeah.
I want to know what sparked this idea to release physical content when bands nowadays typically aren't doing it?
So, I mean, many things. First off, I'm a big fan of physical content. If somebody's got a new, like, even if they got a cassette, I'm going to buy that. And then I'll go listen to their stuff on Spotify too. That's cool. But like, I like owning the CD. And it also helps the bands a lot more other than the pennies that they're going to get from Spotify. So yeah, I mean, that was a big part of it. Another thing is that I personally am a fan of my band. I know that sounds weird, but like, I like to have physical copies of the stuff that we do. I'm proud of the work that we've put out. So like, every CD that we have, like everything we've done, like poster wise, show flyers, I have on my wall. And this is another cool thing to put up on my wall. And it's, you know, it's a cheap purchase. And I mean, you know, you get to actually own it. And then we'll eventually put it on Spotify, you know, if you want to check it out then. But I mean, I'm just a big fan of having physical media. My dream would be able to put out a record of everything that we, you know, have. But it's very costly.
Sure.
Yeah.
I think the other thing that is so important about physical content is there are memories attached to it.
Yeah.
And as time passes and that physical media ages, anytime you look back on it, you're reminded of that place and time and the memories associated with it. And I just think that's fucking cool.
Yeah. That's a really good point. And another good point is that our very first CD, which we're going to re-record because the quality wasn't the best. We're a lot better now. This is like our very first thing we ever did. But like, you can't find it online anymore. Like if you don't have the physical copy, you can't hear it. And I know we're not the only band like that. I know that there's plenty of bands where like, if you don't buy that CD, you know, maybe it's on Spotify and then eventually they take it off and then you don't have access to it anymore. Maybe if you dig around enough shady websites, but like in general, stuff can go away if you don't have a physical copy of it. So I'm a big fan of it. Anything that I really like, if it's like a movie, I go to the theater and see a movie. If it was okay, I'll probably like wait till it's on Netflix or whatever and watch it on Netflix. But if I love a movie, if I go to a movie and I'm like, this is like my new favorite movie, I'm going to buy the Blu-ray when it comes out. It's just how I am. Maybe it's old school. I don't know, but that's just how I am.
I actually think it's really important for bands to release physical media because when you have that content to give away and you put it in the hands of someone, it becomes real to that person's experience and their existence. Whereas digital content on Spotify or whatever, it's so passive. It's easy to scroll past it or just look at the thumbnail and, you know, move on to the next one.
Yeah.
But when you have that physical content to give to somebody, that becomes a place and a time for that individual as well.
Absolutely.
I think that bands should be doing it more.
Yeah, and it's cool. It's something to put on your table. You know, you always want more stuff on your table. You don't want to just have two t-shirts. You know, you want to have varied items. You know, you want to have cassettes, CDs, stickers, buttons, like whatever you can put out there because somebody will buy it. Sorry, my computer just died. No, I just went by there.
No worries.
But yeah, so I mean, it's important to have it on your table and, you know, it provides something for somebody to buy. And then if they really like you, they're going to ask you to sign it. How are you going to sign something on Spotify? There's plenty of people that enjoy that. Yeah. So, I mean, the people collect signatures and stuff from bands they like. You can't do that.
I have to take a moment to make a shameless plug, but it relates to this topic. I released this earlier this year with my good buddy, Bill Johnson, a 40-ounce booking. This is a sampler of all of the bands that are going to be playing at 40 Fest, January 2023. And there's actually an updated version of this. It's got more bands coming out. This one's got 15 tracks. and I just announced today that I've launched a website for Rebellion Noise Records where you can order these. And it's free. All you have to cover is a $5 flat rate of shipping. But you can also make a donation to our Venmo if you'd like. And I've also got to give a shout out to my buddy Matt and Destruct Fux, who put those together for us. also they're putting out that physical media. So shout out to them. But if you would like a copy of either the 40 Fest sampler or Punk Rock Attack Volume 1, go to Rebellion Noise Records Instagram, click the link in the bio, and you'll be taken to our website where you can order it there. Moving on. Again, if you have questions for myself or for Ryan, just tap that question mark icon on your device and submit your questions there. We're going to go ahead and move into the live Q&A portion. Let's see here.
All right, what we got?
First question comes from our good friends and Oil Change Punx. What are both of your thoughts on Chopping Mall? By far, my favorite film of all time. Yellow Stitches do a sick song about the movie, too. Ryan, okay. Your thoughts?
I love Chopping Mall. Yesterday I was looking online and I found a shirt with the Killbots on it. And I instantly had to order it. And I'm going to be wearing it the 29th at our 29th show at Sabbath Brewing. But yeah, I love that movie. It's one of my favorites. It's one that confused me the first time I watched it because I thought it was going to be like a slasher movie in a mall, especially with the poster with the hand grabbing the bag. I just thought it was like, oh, this is like a slasher. It's going to be like some guy killing everyone. Nope, it's robots. It's security robots. And I also love the aesthetic of the movie, all the neon lights and everything. I'm a huge fan of Chopping Mall, and I'm going to have to check out that song because that's right up my alley.
My thoughts on it, I don't have any because I actually have not seen it. So I'm going to
miss out.
I'm going to have to add it to my list to watch this month.
Yeah, it's excellent. It's really, really fun.
Ryan, I'm curious. I know you mentioned earlier that your favorite franchise is the Friday the 13th franchise. Would you say that one of those movies is your favorite horror movie of all time?
There's one that's up there. Jason Lives, part 6. That's my favorite. That's when you get zombie Jason, when he's resurrected with the lightning and he comes out and he's just kicking down doors and murdering the shit out of everybody. But that's probably my favorite one. But I still have a fondness for Jason X because I saw it in theater as a kid, and I remember just being so excited at Mega Super Jason that was destroying everybody. And I got to see titties, so that was cool because I was a kid, and I was like, this rules.
Yeah, it can't be a horror movie if there's not pointless nudity, right?
Yeah, exactly. It's just a thing.
I also wanted to ask, what's your thoughts on the Friday the 13th reboot that they did in 2013.
I don't have a ton of thoughts on it because I only saw it once, but I didn't dislike it. I thought I was going to hate it, and there were things about it I liked. I liked how it kind of sped through the first two movies to get to the hockey mask because obviously that's what everybody wants to see. And it's better than certain elements of the franchise, but overall it's not my favorite. It's not one that I rewatch, and I bought that box set and I watched every single one in that box set, including Jason Goes to Hell, which is a horrible movie that still has some awesome things, but it's bad. And then I got to that one and I was like, nah, I'm good. I'm all good on that.
I actually saw that one in theaters too. And I was surprised at how much I liked it because
it's not bad.
Gonna hate it. But I kind of like, some of the throwback to the original. It felt like they tried to honor a lot of the earlier movies, but just make it more contemporary. So I thought that was cool.
For sure. I thought that the Nightmare on Elm Street remake was garbage.
Oh, God. Let's not even get started on that.
Yeah, that one was really, really bad.
Next question actually comes from my beautiful wife. She says, thoughts on the new Munsters?
Okay. Lighting was cool. I like the lighting. The set pieces were cool. Everything else was terrible, in my opinion. I know a lot of people that really liked it, so I'm not the type of person that's going to hate on anything. But I didn't I sat there just stone-faced the entire time, just being like, what is happening? Am I supposed to be laughing right now? I don't understand what's happening. Well, who is this for? But some people liked it. So, you know, I'm happy for them. And if that's your jam, that's awesome. But it wasn't for me. I'm curious to hear what you thought.
So my wife threw it on Saturday. And had she not thrown it on, I would not have even bothered. I was exhausted. It wasn't Saturday, it was Sunday. I was exhausted because on top of, you know, working my normal job, I also decided to work a haunt this year. And so Friday and Saturday night, I was up really late. So Sunday I was kind of wiped out, and then our daughter was not feeling well. She going through a horrible teething episode. She was, you know, she had a fever. So the mood in the house was kind of already like, it's kind of a rough day. So I didn't even make it through it. I fell asleep like probably half an hour into it, maybe 45 minutes. And my thoughts on it were, okay, I could see how this would be fun for kids.
Yeah, absolutely.
But for myself, someone who loves the horror genre and, you know, is older, I fucking just can't stand that Sherry Moon was cast to play Lily.
Would have been my choice. I don't, but
yeah. I get it. You know, she's Rob Zombie's wife. You know, I get that.
Yeah.
But she is too old to play that character. And it's obvious in several of the scenes that she's the age that she is. And I'm not hating on women that are her age or anything like that. It's, you know, it's a character that was established a very long time ago that was a younger character. And this movie is supposed to be about their love story. So you're going back even further than what the original series is about.
Yeah, because this would before X-Men that we saw.
Yeah, it would make you think that if this is their origin story and how they met, wouldn't they have been like in their 20s?
Yeah, you would think. You would think. I guess you could argue that she's a vampire, so it doesn't really matter. But I get what you're saying.
Yeah. So for those reasons, I didn't really care for it. Yeah. And I'm not going to put it on and watch it all the way through at my own choosing.
Yeah. It's one of those things where it's like, I liked the set design. I liked the way everything looked mostly. The only thing I didn't like about it was the script. Like, I just felt like this, it was like weird and clunky, and like I couldn't tell. I was like, is this the best take they could have used of this part? You know, like, I don't know. It was just very odd, and the pacing was weird. And then by the time it really got going, it was just over.
Yeah.
So by the time you get to the Munsters and you're like, oh, here's the thing I'm like here for, it's just, it ends.
Yeah. Okay, we're going to move on because I'm over it.
I'm on that.
Let's see here. Our good friend Bill Johnson of 40 Ounce Booking says, best Casket Creatures show you ever played. Best show you have ever seen. Plug Joe Stryker movie.
That's all very, very, very good. Best show I've ever played, man. That is really, really, really tough. So we did, I would say we opened for the Misfits, not the lineup that everybody wanted to see, but we opened up for the Misfits in Heaven, at the Masquerade, at the old Masquerade, sold out show. Wild, and we just had a blast. We had the crowd in the palms of our hands, and I just thought it was an incredible night, and I still think about it. And some of the pictures from that show just are like some of my favorite ever. So I think us playing with the Misfits, the Jerry only fronted Misfits, regardless of how you feel about them, it was a great opportunity for us. And we had a really, really good time doing it. And that would be very, very up there on the list, I think. As far as best show I've ever seen, man, that's tough. Probably the show with Alice Cooper opening up for Iron Maiden, the England tour in Atlanta at Lakewood. That was probably the best show I've ever seen. Just great set list all around. I'd never seen Alice Cooper. I grew up on Alice Cooper. Obviously, I'm a fan. That was an incredible show. And I'll never forget that. And as far as Joe Stryker, that was a movie that I co-directed with Kevin, the guitarist of the Casket Creatures, one of the guitarists. And it's a fun, ridiculous, over-the-top action movie, but it has like a horror element to it, of course, because the Casket Creatures were involved. Everyone in the band is in the movie. It's very low budget. We spent like, $2,000 to make the entire movie, and it's a full length. I'm sure Rob Zombie could go watch my movie and pick it apart if he wanted to. But it's a lot of fun. It's very violent. It's very over the top, gratuitous 80s-ness. So if you're into that kind of thing, let me know and I can get you a copy of it.
Awesome.
And we are working on a sequel. So
just very cool. Yeah, hearing you talk about the Misfits and Alice Cooper is getting me super excited because I'm going to be seeing both of them on my birthday. They're playing Dallas, and I'm really, really excited. It's going to be an awesome show.
That's a dream show, dude. That's a great lineup.
Yeah, man. And my buddy John, who played bass in my last band, he's actually teching for the Misfits, so he's getting me all access, and I'm fucking stoked, man. I'm really hoping that I'm going to get to meet Danzig and Alice Cooper.
Dude, that would be awesome. That would
be epic, man.
Hell yeah. On your birthday? Can't beat that.
Yeah, and like two of my biggest idols, like, come on.
Yeah, that's awesome.
Okay, we've got a few more questions here. The Shivers, they ask, Ash versus the Evil Dead.
Loved it. I mean, it was great. I wish it had kept going, but I enjoyed the shit out of it. It was a great show start to finish. Yeah, I think my only complaint is that I wish that they would do more. I also like the Evil Dead remake, which I know a lot of people didn't like, but I want to see more of that as well. I'm a huge Evil Dead fan all around, huge Army of Darkness fan, and the more Evil Dead we can get, the better, in my opinion.
Yeah, I thought the show was cool, too. We've actually talked about it a couple of times on this show, and sadly, I have not finished it. I started it. And then I got super busy with life, basically when my daughter was born, and I just haven't made time for it since then. But I thought the show was really cool. And, you know, the cool thing about Evil Dead is just like the cinematography on that, you know, like it has its own vibe.
Oh yeah. Yeah. They invented a style that a lot of people know.
Yeah. It's kind of like, when Blair Witch came out, you know, like, first movie to kind of really do that whole handheld camera thing that, you know, just become it. It became a style, you know, that is used in horror kind of indefinitely now.
Yeah, for good and bad.
Right, right.
We're talking about Friday the 13th. I want to see a found footage Friday the 13th movie. I think that could be amazing. Just someone exploring the campsite and then some Jason stuff happens. That's one of the few times I think that found footage could be really cool and used in an interesting way to reboot a franchise. Cause we haven't had enough Jason in a while.
Yeah. I had heard or read something somewhat recently that there may be a new one in the works. Cause I think it was, there was some legal battle going on with the right.
Yeah, there were. Yeah, or there was, but I don't know if they've figured all that out or not. There was also a problem with the video game because there was, like, they were making new content for the Friday 13th video game, and then all of a sudden they just had to stop because of legal issues, and it was a whole scandal, whole thing.
Yeah, I read something, I want to say like a couple of months ago, some article that I came across on Facebook, because I follow a couple of like, you know, horror pages that are just all about horror news.
Yeah.
And from what I remember, they said that the legal battle had ended so that they could finally move forward with shit. So hopefully that's true, and we can get more of that content, because I'd love it.
Yeah, that'd be awesome.
Next question. This is a really awesome question, actually. It comes from that British guy. He says, I know you already kind of spoke about this, but how do you not fall into tropes for song topics? Every time my band and I have tried to write horror punk songs, we resort to horror stereotypes and then just chuck the song.
Yeah, man, it's easy to do. It really is. And we just straight up do it sometimes. It happens. But I mean, a lot of the stuff that I'm very, very proud of with this band comes with like equating a horror movie or a horror premise to actual stuff that has happened in my life. And kind of using like my own personal experience and like putting myself in a situation to like reflect what's going on, even if it's like seemingly about a movie or like something that somebody knows about, I like kind of take elements of myself, put myself into the situation and add that personal touch to it that I think kind of adds a new element to it.
I can see how it would become a little disheartening writing new material and kind of falling into that whole, well, this is just another stereotypical horror thing. And like, then feeling like, okay, it's just not worth it or whatever, because musicians notoriously, we are our own worst critics.
Yeah, for sure. Yeah. And there's been plenty of times that we've had to just scrap stuff that was probably savable, but we're just, you get in your head about it. And you're like, no, nope, this sucks. We just got to ditch it. And you just have to come back to it later, hopefully. But yeah, it's easy to do. But I mean, I think there's enough real life horrors and there's enough horror out there to where you can easily come up with some interesting concepts if you just dig deep enough. I mean, I think like the best album we ever created, which is an album called Deranged, I think that that album is by far lyrically, musically, everything, my favorite album we've put out. And a lot of that is because I was going through a really rough patch and like a lot of life stuff and, you know, divorce and stuff like that. But I mean, I think that taking those real life elements and then putting them into like, oh, here's this spooky music. I think, you know, kind of provides something unique. And maybe that's an approach you guys can take to it. You know, take a horror premise you like, and then, you know, kind of insert yourself into that and then use real things that have happened to you to kind of express the feelings of being in that situation. Does that make sense?
I was just going to say that I couldn't agree with you more, because I think the most important thing about being an artist is being authentic.
Yeah. Yeah, I agree.
And I don't think it matters what genre you're in. The authenticity is what is going to make your music, your message believable and have you connect with your audience.
Yeah. I mean, so for instance, 112 Ocean Avenue, the song you were starting the show out with, I mean, it's about Amityville Horror and it's about a guy that's murdering his family, but it's also like putting yourself in that situation. How is he dealing with that? How awful is this whole situation? You know, and just kind of going in the headspace of that, I think kind of helps come up with something, like you said, authentic. Even though it's about a silly premise about a spooky ghost movie, you can still add that authenticity and that kind of unique look at it, as opposed to just literally just going through the, you know, what happens in the movie. That doesn't help anybody. You can just watch the movie.
Sure. Yeah, I'm going to touch on this a little bit too, because I'm working on a new project that is horror themed, and I can relate to this topic And I can also give some feedback to our audience member, that British guy who's asking this question. So the new project that I'm working on is essentially a storytelling project. And everybody that is in the project, that's in the band and whatever, they're all characters. But I'm using my own life experiences to a degree to help tell this story. And when you draw from your own life experiences and you put it into your songs, you believe it because you're already connected to it. And having that connection to it is what is also going to help provide some of the confidence. And when you have that confidence in your music, especially live, people notice that shit. So, yeah, I would just, you know, drive that point home, agreeing with you. Like, draw from your own experience, put that in there, and then just put the horror tinge on it.
Yeah, exactly. Because, Lane, that's what we love. You know, it's fun. We don't mind being pigeonholed as, like, the horror band. That's what we are. We wear face paint. We are the Casket Creatures. And we are 100% confident in ourselves about that. But also, you know, sometimes I want to talk about some real shit. And I just thinly disguise it.
Right on. Let's see here. There's some more audience questions. Okay, yes, we've got one more here. This one comes from... Magic Cherry Loca. She asks, who does y'all's paint?
All right, so I'm guessing she means the face paint. We all do it ourselves. We all kind of came up with our own styles. We've had some lineup changes throughout the year, so you know, if people join the band, somebody has to step away, we're like, hey man, this is on you. Like, create your character, create what you want to be on stage in the Casket Creatures. We don't have like a strict policy about it or, you know, anything. It's just like, be yourself, but, you know, do the Casket Creatures thing. You know what we're all about. So, yeah, we do it ourselves. You know, we sometimes it's good. Sometimes we're, you know, backstage and don't have mirrors and we just have to improvise, you know. So it varies. But, you know, it's something that we have a song called Devil's Day. And we specifically say in the song, the face paint is here to stay. Bloody clothes every night and day.
Very cool, man. I love that. The theatrical element to horror and, you know, in music is something that I've always been drawn to. And I think a lot of it started with the Misfits, of course. But what was it for you? Like, was it the Misfits or was there some other band that you saw first that you're like, wow, this is really cool. Like, I love the makeup and what they're doing. What was that for you?
A big, huge inspiration. And like anyone who knows me knows this, a huge inspiration to me is King Diamond. King Diamond, he does like, kind of like similar to what you were talking about, very like deep concept albums. He wears face paint. He sings about, you know, haunted houses and Satan and all this stuff and all this stuff that I love. And he does it in such a theatrical, over-the-top way where he's, you know, building a haunted mansion on stage and he's setting coffins on fire and stuff like that. And it's just so cool and theatrical. And I found him pretty early on and, you know, it was like, oh, I love this. I want to do something like this. Not that specifically, because I can't sing crazy falsetto vocals and all this stuff. I don't want to do that specifically, but his style and like his vibe. And then also a huge part of it's Alice Cooper, because I grew up with Alice Cooper records and tapes from my dad. And I was introduced to like horror being associated with music very early. So for me, that was like a no brainer. I was like, that's a thing. So, you know, and then, you know, Kiss and stuff like that, that I was introduced to. So there's a lot of inspirations there.
Yeah, man, I have a really fond memory. I saw King Diamond with Slayer on
wow.
the Mayhem Festival.
Yeah, I was there. Was it Atlanta?
No, no. It was in Southern California.
Oh, okay. At
the Glen Helen Pavilion, but I was fortunate enough to be side stage for that.
Nice.
And it's just fucking cool, you know, to see King Diamond.
Yeah.
You know, right there. He's coming back with Merciful Fate shit too.
Oh yeah, I know. I already got tickets.
That's fucking rad. But also to be, you know, like, I don't know, I think I was 10 feet away from Kerry King when Slayer was playing, and it's just like, this is insane.
Yeah, that's awesome. I was at the Atlanta date, and we somehow managed to get in the front row, and boy, that show just blew my mind, man. I'd seen King before that, but that show, I was like, this is the best shit ever. So, yeah, I'm a huge fan of him, and he's a huge inspiration on how I approach songs lyrically and a lot of that. So,
okay, so now I've got to ask this question. It's kind of controversial, I feel, because it's one of those either, like, love it or hate it topics.
Okay.
What are your thoughts on Ghost?
I actually like him a lot. I get that a lot of people don't understand what they're doing. A lot of people are like, hey, they're not metal. And I'm like, I don't think that they ever said they were. I get the arguments that people make of not liking them, but I got that first album when it came out, and I've been listening to them ever since. And I don't want to sound like the hipster guy, but I've liked them for a long time. Not going to say before they were cool, but I liked it for a long time, and I'm not going to stop liking them. Now, the last album didn't hit me the way that the other ones did. The last album, I was like, okay, this is cool. I'll listen to it occasionally. But those first couple albums, and seeing them live, I mean, it's undeniable the stage presence and the stage show that they put on. They put on an insane live show. Even if you're not a fan, if you get a chance to see them, like, if you're not a fan, you get, like, free tickets or they're on a festival, just watch it because it's entertaining.
Yeah, I have not seen them live. And now that you mention it, like, that's a really good point because I'd like to see them live to compare what that experience is like versus listening to the record, because I'm just not a big fan of production value on their records. I'm not saying that the production value is bad. It's not bad.
It's not for you.
It's just very specific.
Yep.
There's a very specific style that's being used for their songs that I just don't favor.
No, I totally get that. Yeah, that makes a lot of sense. Yeah, a lot of this stuff's very, like, analog sounding, very warm sounding, and especially the first album. But yeah, I completely get that. They hit that specific, like, weird niche of, like, weird and evil and kind of also funny, which, a lot of my favorite bands, you know, that I'm not, like, straight up comedy bands, but, like, even us, like, we do, like, some videos and stuff that are like, you know, hey, we're a little tongue in cheek. We're some silly guys, you know? But I get the vibe, from Ghost that they're, or at least Tobias is a silly dude himself. And I'm a fan.
You know, I think it's interesting and I guess kind of a sign of hope for the future that a band like Ghost are at a point now where they're playing arenas. They're headlining arenas.
Yeah, he's throwing pitches at baseball games.
Yeah, dude, that.
I loved it. I thought it was cool as hell.
When I saw that, I was just like, what is happening here?
I know. It's like we're living in some weird alternate reality. Like, it's like the singer of the satanic band that dresses like an evil pope is throwing baseballs at the White Sox game. But, I mean, hey, you know, good for them. They're doing it.
Yeah, I mean, you know, we're kind of getting to this scary point where a lot of our heroes are on the way out. I really hate to even say that. But, you know, you mentioned Kiss earlier. That's one of my favorite bands of all time.
Yeah.
And, you know, they're hanging it up. I know they've said in the past that they're going to hang it up and then they come back. But I think this time it's absolutely for real. I mean, these guys are in their mid-70s now. They're approaching their mid-70s. You know, so I don't foresee them continuing on after this. And even Alice Cooper, you know, he's really getting up there.
Yeah.
And my hat's off to him that he's continuing it on. But the reality is they're not going to live forever. And the torch is going to have to be passed on. And I'm really curious who are going to be the people that carry that torch. I think Slipknot is undoubtedly one of those bands. I mean, they're already massive. They've been playing arenas for a long time now. So there's no doubt that that band's going to continue on, especially because they're still young enough to keep going for another couple of decades easily.
Yeah, for sure.
And I think Ghost is one of them. But who else is going to rise in the ranks over the next, you know, decade or so, that's in this vein of theatrical, horror, rock, and, you know, become the new group that is going to carry on, you know, the legacy of this genre? I'm really curious to see what's going to happen.
Yeah, and unfortunately, I don't have an answer for you. I mean, my only answer would be Ghost, because Ghost is like that kind of genre that shouldn't be big, but they somehow are getting very, very big. And it seems like that's just going to get more and more as people discover their music. Because apparently something happened where they blew up on TikTok or something, and now they're bigger than ever. So I feel like they absolutely will. Zombie's still holding it down. I went and saw Rob Zombie. Like, I know I was, like, talking about how I didn't like the Munsters, but, like, I went and saw the show. We got to see that from side stage, and that was pretty sweet. And he puts on a hell of a show. The Misfits are killing it right now, yeah. You know, on their shows. I mean, obviously. So yeah, I mean, there's bands still doing it, but as far as young, like, new bands, man, I don't even know. I wish I did. I'd love to hear about them if somebody has some suggestions, but, I know there's like Twin Temple is one that's, kind of picking up a little steam. They're like a satanic doo-wop kind of thing, but they're kind of blowing up a little bit. But yeah, I don't know, man. I don't know. We'll see.
Yeah, man, it's just going to be interesting to see what happens.
Yeah, for sure.
I think it's great that, you know, Ghosts are out there and attracting a large audience, because, you know, hopefully that's a good sign for the rock genre in general, not just horror rock, but, you know.
Yeah.
I mean, we've been living, I would say for like the last two decades, hip-hop and country have really just been dominating as far as, like, what is attracting the biggest audiences.
Yeah.
And I'm kind of hoping that rock will make more of a comeback.
Yeah, I'm hoping so, man. I really am. But we'll see. I mean, it's never going away. Punk rock, metal, it's all staying here. It's all here to stay.
Absolutely. And, you know, there's people like us that are passionate about it that are going to continue to pursue it until their dying breath.
Yep, for sure.
Having said that, man, it's time for us to wrap it up. I've really enjoyed this conversation and hanging out with you here on Instagram. Thank you so much for making time out of your day to come on here and talk about the Casket Creatures. Before I let you go, do you have any shout outs you'd like to give?
Yeah. So please, if you're listening to this, keep an eye on the Facebook, social media, all that stuff, because we're going to be posting new songs, new show dates, hopefully tour dates, music videos, all that stuff. So the Cast Creatures have a ton of content that's coming out, and it's just ramping up right now. We kind of like sat down. This is a little too much information, but we kind of sat down like about a month ago. And we're like, hey, we haven't put anything out since 2019. We're playing shows, of course, but like, we need to step this up to the next level. We already have like 20 songs written. We need to just ramp it up, play as much as we can, put out as much stuff as we can. because we love this band and we're passionate about it. So you're all about to see a lot from the Casket Creatures. As far as other plugs, definitely check out my other band, Neon Warlords, which is another project I'm very, very passionate about. Having a lot of fun with it. Just look us up and see if it's your cup of tea. A lot of like synth stuff, thrash stuff. It's a lot of fun. But all of it sounds like the soundtrack to like your favorite 80s movie. So it's a lot of good stuff. Yeah, that's pretty much it as far as plugs, man.
Awesome. Before I let you go, would you like to announce who next week's guest is going to be?
Yes, the next guest is David Disorder from Direct Action Shirts.
David Disorder, if those of you in the audience aren't familiar with him, he he prints a lot of really cool t-shirts for the scene. He's done some great artist collaborations. He did some of the new designs for Defiance to promote their newest record that came out earlier this year. He's done some cool Seditionary style designs. And he also has put on a festival in Europe that I think has kind of been out of commission for the last few years because of COVID and whatnot. So maybe he's going to be bringing that back. I don't know. So we'll find out when we interview him next week. And one last thing, I just need to mention this one more time to the audience. Rebellion Noise Records. We have a website now that is live. You can find that by going to our Instagram page and then clicking the link on the bio. If you would like to order a copy of either the 40 Fest 2023 sampler or Punk Rock Attack Volume 1, you can do that just by paying the $5 flat rate shipping. The CD is yours for free. And you can also donate there to our Venmo if you'd like. Having said that, this is the end, guys. And to play us out, again, it is 112 Ocean Avenue by the Casket Creatures. Thanks, everybody. We'll see you next time. Later, brother.
See you, man. Good talking.
You too.
Got to die.